Good morning, church. Will you join me in prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day, Lord, for the beautiful day you've given us. Another opportunity at life, another opportunity to love others, to share your gospel with someone. Thank you for the freedom that we have to worship together in this place. Thank you that our congregation is dedicated to the work here, Father. Thank you for the ongoing work we have at the building behind me, and for what that could mean for growth and reaching more people. Thank you especially for the generosity that this body has shown in giving generously so that the building could be a reality, and for the youth room that's a part of that building, Lord, we just thank you for the generosity of those that have made it possible for that room to be somewhere that our youth and our children can call home here at this congregation, Father. We're excited for what the building and the youth room can mean for our young people to grow in their faith and to grow in their love for one another and to share the gospel themselves with those that they know. Lord, we'd like to pray especially now for our whole country during this time with an election coming up and with what seems like just endless problems and division. We would ask that you help us here in this congregation be a body and a community that can stay together and united. United in love for each other and united in love and dedication to you, Lord. We pray especially for the elders and the leadership here in the church, the staff, as we go through these challenging times with the pandemic and other challenges, just that they be led by your Spirit, Father, and make the decisions that will be best for this body going forward. Lord, we ask all these things through the name of your Son, Jesus, who died for us, who loves us even to this day, and who paved the path for us to achieve salvation. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
So, like I said, moralistic therapeutic deism was first coined in 2005 as a critique of the views of Christianity of adolescence in 2005. And then it went a step further in this book where he critiqued the parents of the adolescents of 2005 because they didn't come up with it on their own, right? And then he kind of insinuates that maybe, perhaps, probably for sure, this has been going on for a long time. Okay, this is something that's kind of been passed down from generation to generation, and the ball kind of just gets bigger and bigger, as we say, in that way, right? So this is something that applies to everybody. This is, like, it's not just our youth of today, and it's not just millennials, and it's not just Generation X. Like, this is something that I think a lot of us subscribe to in some way at some times, not always, and definitely not all the time. So I hope that by the end of this, you'll see why a youth minister of today would need to know about this, but I think you'll also see how possibly you might be a part of this as well. So in order for us to get on the same boat, though, moralistic therapeutic deism, we need to define our terms. So moralistic means characterized by or expressive of a concern with a doctrine or system of moral conduct. Therapeutic would mean having a beneficial effect on the body or mind. And deism was a movement, or is a movement, or system of thought advocating natural religion, emphasizing morality, and in the 18th century denying the interface of the creator with the laws of the universe. So then, by combining those three, this is kind of like my definition, I guess, but kind of just combining those three terms, I would say that moralistic therapeutic deism can be defined as a movement or system of thought advocating for natural religion that will have beneficial effects on the body or mind by being driven by morals. Now, on paper, when you look at that, it doesn't sound terrible, sure, right? Like morals, good thing, right? Things that are good for our mind and body, also a good thing. Those are fine. But we're gonna look at where all of this kind of leads, and we're gonna look at the five main points that moralistic therapeutic deism would say or suggest. So the first point is, a God exists who created and ordered the world and watches over human life on earth. So what I'm going to do for each point is I'm going to bring out the truth in it, and then we're going to talk about what it's kind of lacking or missing, and then we'll kind of go from the very end where that all goes. So the first one, a God exists who created and ordered the world and watches over human life on earth. Genesis 1:1, right? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Amen, right? Absolutely. And that's huge. That's a huge part of Christianity, to acknowledge that God created everything and that he ordered over it, right? And this is pinnacle of Christian faith. That is a necessity. However, you have this idea, right, where it says, and watches over human life. As I said earlier, you know, with deism, there's a lack of interaction, right? And so this lends itself to something like this. Jesus is watching, always watching, right? And that's obviously problematic, right? This leads to an incorrect view of God, an incorrect view of God's love for us. If you see God as Father, God is watching over us, great. Thank you so much, God, for watching over me. If you view God as only judge, right, and you only see him as the one who's looking to condemn you rather than save you, you can see why this would be an issue, right? That next step of God is watching over us, he's not engaging with us, and Jesus is watching, which I got this actually from when I was in debate in high school. I was the only Christian, I think, out of like my 12-person team, and they put that sign up just to mess with me. And I was like, yeah, like you're right, but I hate that, right? And like kind of denouncing what that looks like and how God is a loving God. So then the second step would say God wants people to be good, nice, and fair to each other as taught in the Bible and by most world religions. So this one's pretty simple as well, right? God, good, nice, and fair. Those are good things to be, right? Those are quality. Those are biblical principles. All those things are wonderful. God himself is good, nice, and fair, right? These are fine, but they're lacking something, right? There's something more to Christianity. Being a Christian means being courageous, being bold, being triumphant, right? It means stepping boldly into your faith and doing things that sometimes may not be as nice, because it's the most loving thing to tell your brother or sister that they're in sin, right? To step into that boldly and say, hey, like you're messing up and you need to correct your life, where moralistic therapeutic deism would say that may not have been the nicest thing to do. The nicest thing to do would be to mind your own business, right? But Christianity is an interactive faith, amen? Right? And it is a community, right? That's why we're doing this during a pandemic, right? That's why we're still here, because we value the community. Which, speaking of the pandemic, it was 7 months ago today when the NBA stopped their season. So we have been in this for 7 months, and this community holds strong. And so I appreciate that, and it's good to be here today. Now, Christ alone is the one that saves. And this is important because you see at the very end, it says, as taught in the Bible and by most world religions. And that's obviously the caveat, right? And as Christians, we need to acknowledge and we have to acknowledge that Christ alone is the one who saves. Amen? Okay, just making sure we're awake, right? So if Christ is the one that saves, it's okay to acknowledge that you're right. Right? It's okay to do that. But and by being right, necessarily some things are wrong, right? And I'm not here to denounce everybody else. That's not the point. I'm here to advocate for Christ. But by advocating for Christ, you're proclaiming that he is the truth. And by proclaiming Christianity and being baptized into his salvation, you're proclaiming that, right? And so we have to be bold in that. We have to step forward in that. John 14:6 is the text we're going to read today. Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Amen? So now, the next point that moralistic therapeutic deism would push is they would say people who subscribe to this sometimes subconsciously, I want to say, because perhaps it might be us sometimes, the central goal of life is to be happy and to feel good about oneself. Now, I want to give a lot of credit to this one because I think a lot of times we miss this as Christians, especially within our tradition. We like to value our sinfulness in a weird way. Like, I am a sinner. I am no good, right? And there's value in recognizing your sin, right? Because if we live like we have no sin, then we live like we need no Savior, right? And so we have to acknowledge our sin, and that's good, and that's wonderful. But sometimes it's also good to acknowledge our salvation and acknowledge what's different about us and acknowledge what's new. Now, a lot of us know Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But then the verse after that says, and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. And are justified by his grace as a gift. You're not, like, I think I preached on this before because this is the paramount of Christian faith, is that we're not just forgiven, we're justified. You're given reason. Christ says, this is different. You're no longer identified by your sin, you're identified by Christ. And Christ isn't identified by his sin, right? He's identified by the salvation. And so we have to align ourselves the same way. So when moralistic therapeutic deism says the central goal of life is to be happy and to feel good about oneself, there is some truth in that. You should be happy. You should feel good about who you are because you are a co-heir with Christ of the salvation which God has bestowed on all of mankind. All right? And that is good news, church. And you're a part of that. We are brothers and sisters with Jesus Christ. I can't imagine if my brother was Jesus Christ, right? Like, let's go. That's so exciting, right? And we get to enjoy that. We get to enjoy the inheritance. Romans 5:8-11 says, but God shows his love for us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved from him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Did y'all catch that? While we were still sinners. Right? We are not defined by our sin. We are defined by Christ, and we are Christians. And that is good news. So, giving credit to our moralistic therapy, like, there is truth in saying that the end goal is to feel good about yourself, right? Okay, that's good. But as I said a little bit ago, there's a lack of judgment in this, right? If the whole goal is just to be happy, that's fleeting. That's fleeting. Sometimes it's good to step into sorrow, right? And properly address what it looks like to lose a life, or what it looks like to lose a friendship, or what it looks like to lose a belonging, or whatever. You know, it's okay to step into that. We rejoice with those who rejoice, and we mourn with those who mourn, right? And we step into that, and it's shallow, right? It's just happiness. Like, there's not a whole lot there, right? And if our end goal for ourselves is to be happy, then kind of our end goal is for someone else to be happy. And like I said earlier, stepping in and telling our brother and sister that they're messing up, it's probably not going to make them happy, right? Like, I don't know about y'all, but when I receive critique, I don't feel great after that, right? I'm like, that stinks. I've got things to reevaluate, right? And that's harsh and that's critical, but it's good because that's how we grow. That's why this community matters. If this community was just a feel-good, then we would just, I don't know, eat Rudy's barbecue every day, and I don't know, eat chocolate cake after that, and eat Miss Mary's pie, and everything would be fine. We never talk about Christ changing us from the inside out, right? So, the central goal of life is to be happy and to feel good about oneself, has value, but it's missing that next point. So, on to point 4. God does not need to be particularly involved in one's life except when God is needed to resolve a problem. Now this one, I think the wording alone, I think everybody here is like, incorrect. But let's give some credit where credit's due. God delights when we reach out to him no matter what. God is never angry whenever his child reaches out to him. Okay, I want to say that. God is not like Theoden from Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers. Okay? So you have the Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers. Where is God? That's a great, great quote. So in the Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers, let's do this quickly. Raise your hand if you've seen Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers. Most, less than half. That's disappointing. It's great. Tolkien was a Christian writer. Watch it. So in this movie, though, so you have this powerful bad army, okay, the evil, the bad guys, right? And there's tens of thousands, if not more, of this bad army, okay? And they're sweeping through and just killing everybody in sight and destroying their villages. And then you have the good guys who are, you know, struggling. And so these people, they go to Helm's Deep. Say Helm's Deep. Helm's Deep. Okay, I'm just making sure we're all on the same page. So Helm's Deep is this really strong fort that's built into the side of a mountain. So you have the back side of them as the side of a mountain. It comes out like this, and there's a huge wall, tens of feet high, that goes right across the front, and then they can stay safe behind it. It's a great place to go if you're the underdog, right? You can go back there and be safe, and everything's going to be okay. But there's some people there. You got like a small collection of like one city, and then like a few people that are coming to help. Man, that is a lame way to say that Aragorn and Legolas and Gimli are there, but they are. So Aragorn has this conversation with the king of the city who's run away to Helm's Deep. And so they're at Helm's Deep. They know that this enemy is approaching. And Aragorn reaches out to the Theoden. And he says, call for help. We need help. Call for help. And Theoden says, who will I call? Our friendships aren't as strong as yours, Master Aragorn. We don't have those relationships. And Aragorn replies, call for Gondor. Gondor will answer. And then Theoden turns, as you can see in this picture, and he says, Gondor, where was Gondor? Where was Gondor when the Westfold fell? Where was Gondor when our enemies closed in around us? No, my friend Aragorn, we are alone. And I tell you that to tell you that God is not like Theoden. Whenever we reach out to him, whenever we need him in our desperate times, God doesn't say, oh, now you want me. Where were you calling to me whenever things were going only kind of bad? Where were you when you were sinning just a little bit instead of experiencing this crazy thing? Where were you when things were great? Why weren't you appreciating me then? That's not our God. Our God is always and forever will be grateful whenever his sons and daughters call out to him, no matter what. Okay, so there's value in saying that God does not need to be particularly involved in one's life. Okay, so he's not mad at you in those instances when you do call out to him. However, God, as we know, does desire and is worthy of being a full participant, an active participant in all of our lives. He is always there, and we need to recognize him as such, right? It's good to acknowledge that God is present in the good times and in the bad. It's good to acknowledge that it is only by him that we have oxygen to breathe, and he is the food that we eat, and he sustains us, and he gives us life every single day. Amen? That is good to acknowledge. It's important to acknowledge. Thank goodness our God isn't like Theoden, right? Thank goodness. Now, the fifth point. Good people go to heaven when they die. So I'm going to give credit to this, like I said at first, is that this one is actually 100% correct. We just have to reevaluate what it means to be good. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16 through 20 says, from the ESV, from now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin. I hear this out. So that in him we might become the righteousness of God. We become the righteousness of God. So it is correct to say good people go to heaven when they die. Absolutely, because we are made good by Christ and made good by God. We become the righteousness. We don't just become righteous, we become the righteousness of God. And that's wonderful. We are made good by God, not by anything we do. Obviously, moralistic therapeutic deism would say goodness is like what we talked about earlier, with good, fair, kind, right? Just good people. You know, just a good old boy, as we might talk about them, right? Like, it's like that. There's value in that, but nowhere near the value of being a Christian. Does that make sense? I hope so. So, as we transition off of those five main points, and we'll come back to those in a little bit, but as we kind of take this next step, why? Why on earth would anybody subscribe to this, right? This was easy. I'm sure most of y'all were like, yeah, Justin, this all makes sense. 100% moralistic therapeutic deism seems stupid, and I am not a part of it, right? And that's great. That's wonderful. But why then would anybody ever subconsciously subscribe to this? Moralistic therapeutic deism is a worldview that has been completely built by culture and has been passed down by theologically lazy parents rather than scripture and word of faith. Okay, this is a critique of all of us, including myself. Like as we get step into that, Matthew chapter 7 tells us that, you know, you have to attend to the plank in your own eye before attending to the speck in a brother's, right? And so what I'm asking you to do is, as we talk about this, let's evaluate ourselves before we start evaluating everybody else who might be dealing with this part of it, okay? Let's really make a critical view of ourselves. I'll tell you, this was, like, planning this sermon was critical on myself as I think about the lessons I've been teaching over there for 2 years. You know, it's like, have I sometimes valued some of this incorrectly, right? So this is something I've had to do a lot of critiquing myself on. The parents were concerned with parenting their children towards societal success rather than scriptural fluency and Christian discipleship. So let me read this quote real fast, this from the book, Moralistic Therapeutic Deism by Christian Smith. Many teenagers know abundant details about the lives of favorite musicians and television stars. Pause, this was written in 2005, so I'm gonna add in TikTokers and YouTubers and professional athletes. Or what it takes to get into a good college, but most are not very clear on who Moses and Jesus were. This suggests that a strong, visible, salient, or intentional faith is not operating in the foreground of most teenagers' lives. I don't know about y'all, but that's a tough one to read, right? As people that are in relationship with adolescents, right? All of us are. Whether you're an adolescent and you've got friends that are adolescents, hopefully, and the rest of this congregation, we all love and care for these adolescents, amen? And so recognizing that it's absolutely true that our teenagers, and we'll say millennials to go up to like Mark's age and down, are really good at being able to know a lot about our favorite musicians or television stars, and we're not great about being able to fully proclaim who Jesus is and what he's done in our lives. I think you might be able to adjust that to yourself as well, right? I'll tell you, like, for myself, it's easy for me to acknowledge that I can name, this is bragging, but not in a good way, I can name all 32 starting quarterbacks in the NFL and what college they went to, right? That's valueless, right? But yet I don't have the Sermon on the Mount memorized. I can't proclaim some truths from scripture, and that's lazy on my part, and that's not good, right? So I have subscribed to part of this by acknowledging that I value other things over God sometimes, right? And I think we can all get there. So, and in order, because it is Youth Sunday, and in order to make this point full, we're gonna play a little game. Okay, don't worry, you can sit down. Like, this isn't, you don't have to stand up, you know, nothing like that. Okay, you get to sit there with your mask on. No, I'm not asking too much. What I'm going to ask of you is, what we're going to do, just to point this out, is I'm going to start singing a song. Okay, that's not in our hymnals. But you know it. If you do know it, sing along with me. I'm going to pull out, and y'all are going to keep it going for just a second so I can hear the volume. Everyone with me? Thumbs up? All right, it's Youth Sunday. Here we go. We're having fun, all right? And just a small town girl, living in a lonely world. Fantastic. All right, next song. Let's go. I know you want to keep singing. I get it. Here we go. Let's go. I can't remember how this one starts. That's sad. All right, well, you know what? That's a good point. Let's go to the next one, because I can't think of how Bohemian Rhapsody starts. Sad. All right, so let's go with this one. So now we're going to go to jingles, okay? We're going to go away from songs. We're going to go into jingles, okay? Ba-da-ba-ba-bop. That's right. How about this one? Give me a break. Give me a break. Give me a break of that. Absolutely. One more. This one, like a good neighbor. Absolutely. Jake from State Farm is there, right? That's great. All right. Now for the less fun part, let's go with scripture. Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. There we go. Okay. How about Genesis 1:27? So God created man in his own image, in the image of God, he created him. Right, good job. That's phenomenal. It's better than I expected. So that's really good. But I hope we also acknowledge the volume difference, right? And this, like we are there's one of two things. Either A, we don't know scripture as well as we know journey, right? Or B, we're less comfortable proclaiming out loud scriptures that we know than we are singing songs that we know. And I think both of those are errors, okay? Both of those are wrong. Both of those are subscribing to this in some way where our theology and the things we align with are more defined by culture than by Christ himself and by scripture, right? Don't worry, game's over, okay? Now, we could spend forever. I wish I was preaching this as a series, right? Each one of those points could have been a full-blown sermon. We've definitely condensed it. We could have a full sermon on talking about how to combat moralistic therapeutic deism. We could talk about the ways to align your life. We could spend a lot of time on that. What I want to do is I want to share two stories of people in this congregation who, by their parenting, are combating moralistic therapeutic deism. The first is I went over to the Bennett's house probably a year ago, definitely pre-COVID, right? So a long time ago. And they had a friend over as well. And I think we were having a crawfish boil. If Katie Bennett knows how to do a good crawfish boil, it was awesome. We're there, and this friend is talking about how he's been reading the Quran. And he says, you know, the Quran, they're praising the same God that we are. And Andy Bennett says, that's not true. Christ, you know, he says, that's not true, and I'll go toe-to-toe with you on that. Right now, I first of all, the fact that that he's willing to do that to a friend is, first of all, really cool to me. Right, I think that's awesome to be able to talk to a friend and say, you're really wrong on this, and I want, not only does, you know, I think Andy even wanted to, because he cares for his friend, right? To say that Christ is the only Savior is important, as we talked about earlier, right? He is combating moralistic therapeutic deism in that way. Another story is the Villanueva family. Jesus Villanueva and Letty Villanueva, and they have three kids, Carlos, Antonio, and Bree. Great family. They've had a lot of heartache through COVID. In the last 2 months, they lost two family members unexpectedly. And it's been really, really hard on them. And Jesus comes up to me. I wish they were here. I'm looking where they usually sit. But Jesus comes up to me after church a couple weeks ago. Tears in his eyes, which if you know Jesus, he's a big guy, big, strong, burly guy, you know. And he's like, Justin, I'm struggling. I'm struggling with what it looks like to be a strong Christian father and a strong Christian husband while my wife and my kids are experiencing so much heartache. And I was like, yeah, like, what have you been doing? He's like, well, we've increased our prayer. I said, what do you mean? And he tells me that his kids, who's a fifth grader, a freshman, and a junior, are praying out loud daily and reading their scripture for an hour a day, daily. And that's good news, isn't it? That is what it looks like for adolescents to see the faith in the forefront. That's what it looks like for them to know this is what it looks like to be a Christian. I wake up and I pray. I wake up and I read scripture. Oh, I've got time in the day? Let's spend that on God rather than scrolling whatever, right? And I think we all can subscribe to that, right? We have an hour of the day. Maybe we go to the news channel rather than going to scripture, right? Maybe we go to whatever else it is, Facebook, whatever, instead of divulging ourselves on God. The Villanueva family and the Bennetts are doing a great job of this, along with other families, okay? I don't have time to praise every single one of our parents. So we have some great families here, okay? Don't feel bad if you're left out, guys. You're loved too. No, I'm just kidding. So I do want to bring up those 5 points now. As we transition into this communion time, I want to just highlight that I've given you a lot to think about, right? Like, moralistic therapeutic deism probably isn't something that you are super familiar with before we started this conversation, and you probably couldn't have spotted if you knew it, right? So now that you know it, now that you can see it, you can acknowledge it in yourself. And so I want you, with these 5 points, as we transition into our communion time, be willing to look up here and see which one of these maybe am I falling slightly into. And maybe it's none of them. That's great. Praise God for that. Pray for a continued strength in that. That's great. That's good news. But if one of these does apply to a part of your life, you think, as you critically analyze yourself, I want you to pray in reflection of that, right? Because we are the body of Christ, enjoying the body of Christ, who is reforming and changing and molding us from the inside out. And it's good to call attention to these things. Remember, don't feel bad about yourself. You're a Christian, okay? So go ahead and get your communions out and get ready to go. what I'm going to do for our prayer time is I've got two prayers from Scripture. The first one is one that we've all heard before. I'm not asking for you to pray along with me. Just pray along in your heads. I'm going to be reading it from Matthew chapter 6. This is the Lord's Prayer, the one where Jesus says, this is how you ought to pray. And I want you, whenever I'm praying this, recognize that this professes something so much deeper than what society and what moralistic therapeutic deism have to offer. Recognize how this prayer is taken from Scripture, recognizes God's role in every aspect of our lives, submission to Him alone, and it praises our salvation. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. In Jesus' name, amen. The second prayer I've taken from Ephesians chapter 1. I've reworded the pronouns to make it make sense for us because Paul was talking to a congregation about his prayers for them. So I've reworded the pronouns to make it sense where we are collectively praying to God. But that's all I've changed. The rest of it is fully intact. And this one brings, I hope it brings attention how wonderful our God is and how wonderful He has treated us. And this is a thanksgiving for the entire Godhead and the everlasting power and love that He has. Let's pray. You have heard our faith in our Lord Jesus and his love toward all the saints. We do not cease to give thanks to you, God, remembering each other in our prayers that you, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give us the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that we may know what is the hope to which you have called us, what are the riches of your glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of your power toward us who believe, according to the working of your great might, that you worked in Christ when you raised him from the dead and seated him at your right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Amen. At this church, we always offer an invitation, and we want to extend that still today. Normally, we ask you to come forward. Obviously, with social distancing and stuff, we're not necessarily asking that. I am going to ask one thing, if just because I know we have a couple of visitors. If you are an elder or a minister, can you stand up real fast just so people can see who you are? So these are the families that are here, and they love you, and they love this church, and they are shepherding and ministering to this flock, myself included. I am the youth minister. Yeah, y'all can sit down. Y'all are worthy of praise, but not right now. I do ask that if you have a prayer request, if you have a rejoicing, these are the people that love you and want to pray with you, and so please do, and please pray with them after services.
It's been a good day. Great lesson, Justin. Thanks for filling in. Always have a conversation or be around Justin when he's expressing himself. When it's over, I feel like I need a certificate of completion so that I've understood it all. He can put a lot of words in a short period of time. So. Thank you, Justin. That was a great message. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for this Lord's Day, for this time to come together in fellowship, hearing the words of life through your word, written word. And Father, we just thank you for the edification and the encouragement of hearing that, and the renewal and the communion and partaking of the emblems of your Son. And Father, edified in fellowship with one another. And We just thank you for the opportunity during this time of restriction due to the pandemic. And Father, we just pray for a vaccine. We pray for a curative pharmaceutical that will bring us back into some level of normalcy in the near future, and that we can get rid of the fear and the unknown of this virus. Father, we ask that you particularly bless and be with those that are fighting the illness, whether it be cancer or the virus or injury or illness of any other kind. Just be with them, comfort them, and heal them, Father. Father, we thank you so much for your son, Jesus, for the assurances of the cross, for a plan of salvation completed at the cross, and all the gifts from the cross. Father, we thank you so much for your love for us. We ask especially that you be with those that have special needs and that are looking to you for answers and for comfort and peace and patience. And Father, we just ask that you be with us and bless us always as we start a new week, Father. Encourage us, give us the will and the want to walk in your way and in your life. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.